Fast and efficient software is great. But without control, speed kills. Security provides the guidance systems. It lowers risk, increases reliability. I'm looking for the ones who know about security, the ones who advocate speed with control. These are the security champions. Welcome to another episode of The Security Champions, where we explore the latest trends and offer thought leadership in the ever-changing world of cybersecurity. I'm Scott Moore, your host. In today's world, artificial intelligence is revolutionizing every aspect of our lives, from the way we work to the way we interact with the world around us. However, like any powerful tool, can also be used for malicious purposes. Generative AI is a type of artificial intelligence that can create new content like text, images, and music. It's already being used today to create more productive workflows, create personalized experiences, and sometimes create fake news as well. It's also creating new concerns in the cybersecurity room. We're going to talk about that today, and we'll be joined by Tom Ryan, founder of Asymmetric Response, and what AI's impact is going to be in the cybersecurity realm in the future. That's on today's episode of The Security Champions. Good to meet you, Tom. Thanks for being on the show. Yes. Tell me, first of all, about you and maybe your background and what got you into AppSec.
So, interesting journey here. So, I always like coming out here to Black Hat and DEF CON. Been coming since 99.
Wow.
Now, what got me into it is back then I was a developer. And we were creating the first Harry Potter website. So I always like to tell people Harry Potter got me into cyber.
That's cool, actually.
All right. Back then, people just tacked stuff, defaced it. It was a little 16-year-old kid, you know, sort of like a lot of what you're seeing now. And it's just evolved. Okay. I always like to tell people where you are now in security, every 5 years, you're going to completely change what you're doing. You know, I started off, you know, doing the developer, then a network pen tester, then I got an AppSec. It was like 2002, you know, back when it was Sanctum at the time, it was AppScan. So that's where my journey started. Then I started the New York OWASP chapter. There was three of us that did it. It was Stan Guzik. He's now the CTO of S&P Platts. Another guy, Peter Stern, and myself. And then it just evolved, and then I stayed involved with it a long time.
So tell me a little bit about how it's changed, because from other people that I talk to, it's always been like this Wild West cowboy thing that has slowly maybe gotten a little bit more organized, but has it? What do you think?
Yeah, it's constantly evolved. So like I said, when I started off with Sanctum, that was back dynamic scanning. And then I had gone to work for Sigil, it was like back in 2008. And that got me in more into the static analysis phase. But, you know, I didn't just stay with Sanctum. You know, back when I went with, you know, a couple of friends of mine, Dennis and Matt Fisher, and I worked for a company called Web Inspect. I'm sure a lot of you remember that one. We literally worked right across the street from each other. And then I just started looking at all the tools, you know. I always like to see what can it really do versus what marketing does. Like, you go around Black Hat, everybody has leader in the space. It's like, man. It's like, do they use the same marketing company?
I'm sure they do. It's the same statement. Everybody's the leading provider of X. Well, so you've attended these conferences before, and you're here this year. What is the hot button in AppSec that everybody's talking about or wants to talk about or needs to know more information about at these conferences? What's the biggest thing of interest?
So one, I always say, is, you know, how the market's drastically changing, number one. And then all the key buzzwords. And how do you differentiate with those key buzzwords? It's like AI this, AI that. It's like, dude, AI has been around forever. You just never realized it. And it's like, oh, it's going to steal our jobs. I'm like, from my experience with it, it's like automation. It just speeds up the process. Is it going to steal everybody's jobs? No. Is it going to steal some? Yes. but that's the reality of everything. If you look at the evolution of time, you don't see us building houses out of hammers and everything, you know, like stone hammers and rock concrete. Remember the days when they used to build brick houses? Now they're all made out of wood?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, it's just evolution and the way things work.
I heard somebody say, AI is not necessarily going to steal your job, but people who understand how AI works and how to use it probably will. So
correct.
So that's maybe where we're going with that.
Well, I got into AI back in 2019, and I'm like, because I started to see where it was going. You know, before that, I played with it in Fortify. I'm like, okay, that's all right. And then I got into it from the security operations side, and I'm like, okay, this is interesting. And then I started to learn, you know, ways to defeat it, you know, ways to improve it, and then the human factor that corrupts it.
So I know a few months ago you were talking about on LinkedIn how you kind of jumped into the whole ChatGPT and generative AI. What was your conclusion from messing around with that?
So one, it's constantly changing. Two, everybody's coming out with their own version of it. Okay, in October I'll probably be talking about a lot of commonalities of exploits I found in platforms. And I'm not talking prompt injections. I'm talking much deeper stuff where PII is totally going to get stolen. It's not somebody cut and pasted stuff. It'll be a lot deeper than that.
And do you think that it helps the script kiddies more? Does it help everybody? Does it bring everybody's boat? Do they all rise with that? And then it just becomes a deeper war, or?
It's two things, okay? One, the script kiddies, they're gonna love it. Okay, see what they can do, what they can't do. Like I wrote a couple of scripts there. You know, I said, okay, do simple things. Okay, keep my machine from locking out. And then I looked at the code, I'm like, dude, they stole this from Stack Overflow.
Right.
This is the exact code from Stack Overflow. And then there were scenarios like, okay, this is interesting. Okay, it's gonna help lazy people because it just created a 10-page slide deck for them. Mm-hmm. And they just go and import it. And then I'm sitting there, well, what if I can compromise this to do this and start? Because nowadays all we hear is you have everybody's AI version. Microsoft has Copilot. Mm-hmm. Okay, which was originally GPT-3. And now since they did the whole big thing with OpenAI, you know, we're gonna see where it goes. I think the biggest problem that people are gonna have is when they say, how do I turn it off? Okay,
yeah, right.
I don't want this in my organization, how do I disable it? Okay,
yeah.
Because from my experience from testing it out, you turn it off, as soon as you reboot, it's automatically turned on.
Right.
Sort of like a lot of your features that happen on like your iPhone. You turn it off and then you gotta go back and make sure nothing has changed.
So Tom, I've always been told follow the money, right? So if we look at where the money is coming from, VC investment firms, where they're putting their money, and I'm sure AI is a big part of that, but where do you see the money being invested? Because that's really where we're gonna see the tools evolve towards mm-hmm. in the next year or so. What are you seeing?
So I see it a lot of different ways. So you see private equity buying up a lot of companies. And what they're doing with it, you know, private equity does what private equity does. First thing they're gonna do is shrink the headcount, see how much money they can make, what their IP is, how they can use it, leverage it. You know, that's usually the first thing. Second thing you're starting to see is all the startups. The way they're getting funding has drastically changed and the amount that they get for funding. So perfect example, my friend John's company, Halcyon. A couple of months ago, they got a Series A that was $50 million, okay? Because they have a specific target, okay? Ransomware was everywhere. So he created an anti-ransomware software that helps protect your, you know, pretty much protect your information. You know, am I compromised? Can I, you know, grab those keys before they encrypt everything? What's the value of that? You know, so he has that and his whole team that do that stuff. And then you have like Horizon 3 AI, you know, right before we got here, we saw the big announcement. You know, they got a 40 million Series C. And what they were doing is they were doing a lot of automated, you know, pen testing, okay? Because that's the whole market. How do we do everything? But the problem is that the key thing that they leave out of everything is that human feature and the value or the problem of that human feature. Because the way I like to look at everything, humans are code. So you take their horoscope sign, okay? What can you tell from that? But then when you take AI and stuff and you go out to like LinkedIn, you do the semantic analysis on a person before you have that conversation with them. So that was a little trick I would always do. I'd always do a little test on a profile of the person before I went to meet them. This is why I know the best way to approach them, what to joke about, different types of sports. And this all stemmed back from when I did the Robin Sage presentation back here in 2010. You know, showing the dangers of social media and your overexposure to social media.
And did it work whenever you would meet somebody? Did it always work out?
Oh, it's always worked out.
Yeah.
You know, and that's always the key thing, because everybody says KYC, know your customer. Mm-hmm. Okay. How often do you go and research that customer, everybody on that meeting list, before you actually talk to them? Because I could tell you a lot of times I've been on calls where I want to hang up with this guy after 5 minutes.
So there's a social engineering part of all this as well.
Oh,
right. So how much does that play into everything else that's going on at the conference? Like, is that, should it be built into all the tools, all the products, or is that just a marketing thing people say?
So I'll give you an example of this. My favorite quote was from Harry Houdini, which is ironic considering we're in Vegas and they have lots of magic shows. So his quote was, "What the eyes see and the ears hear and the mind believes." Okay, so when you turn around and break that down, it's the premise for marketing, deception, and sales. Okay, and also magic, but
right.
That's kind of the way it goes. And where you saw that at the conference, everybody is the leader of this. I saw at least 20 LinkedIn profiles that had posted about it already. They took pictures of all the vendor signs. It's like, do they use the same marketing company? Did they just recycle slides?
So I saw that you posted something on social media not too long ago about protecting your identity, and specifically around protecting children's identity, mm-hmm. and how those are exposed. Can you talk a little bit about that and how you protect your identity and how bad that actually is as a problem?
20x. Okay, and how do you know that is, you're starting to see a lot of regulations on data collection, what they can collect, what they're doing with that data, because on the hacker side of things, they're stealing kids' identities, okay? And that's more like nation state stuff, so they can build out those personas of those people coming out later in time. Now, on the hacker side of things, they're taking those kids' identities, and, you know, like say you have a teenage daughter or teenage son, well, maybe they'll start opening up the credit lines for them because they have all that data, but they have no way of verifying, okay, this is that person. We need their verification first, okay? Everyone's like, oh, but you know, we'll send something to the parents. It's like, if they've been bypassing your parental controls since you're like 11 years old, do you really think that matters? Okay, because everybody wants to be out there. Everybody wants to be an influencer on TikTok, not realizing the amount of information that they're giving. And nowadays with cancel culture, I like to call this more focused on reputational risk management.
Like okay. People doxing you and things.
Right, doxing you, but more, yeah, because think of how a lot of the people that have come out when they're doxing people, they're picking stuff up from 10 years ago that somebody posted. Mm-hmm. Because that's all that they can find. But now they're trying to destroy somebody for something they said 10 years ago. Half the time we don't even remember what we said.
Right. So the name of your company is Asymmetrical Response, which is kind of unique. Why that name and what do you do?
Okay, reason why I named it Asymmetric Response was because everybody likes to think everything's symmetric and fits in a perfect square box. It's not.
Right.
Okay, you look at the human body, nothing is symmetrical.
Okay, you have
especially
one hand.
With me.
you have one hand bigger than the other. You have one foot bigger than the other, and it was just pretty much a physical design. Okay, and what it also determines is your mindset as to how you approach things. Okay, so we have everybody has these run books and playbooks. Says, oh, do it this way. It's like, no, don't do it this way. You have to do it in the business case, what's aligned with your business. In the personal place, it's more like, okay, I need to have this type of response, okay? You have the military, you know, if we attack a military facility, a cyber attack on a military facility or on a power grid company, how quick do you think we're gonna respond to that? Probably within an hour.
Yeah.
Okay, and you won't hear about it on the news, okay? But then you have the other scenario of what happens if there's a hostile takeover on your company, okay? Somebody's doing a hostile takeover, how do I approach this? Okay, do we do a slow and low approach and capture them doing bad things and then, you know, do one way? Or do we retaliate in some way? You know, because back to the Harry Houdini quote, there's a way of doing it through the media and there's a way of remediating, and you could take it to law enforcement.
I see. So tell me about some of the stuff that you've done, some of the stuff that you can talk about.
So lots of things I can talk about. So a few things that, you know, since we're at a casino, I'll bring this one up. So from the casino perspective, you know, I was, you know, we had fun back in the days where we'd get pulled in on red teaming on taking over a casino. Scope of work would take 2 months. The reality of the way some of the stuff was set up then, 2 days.
Wow.
Okay. Because what's the thought process? What's the engineers? How are you gathering your information? And it's drastically changed the way you do stuff. So some of the things that we've started looking at is things more like pattern of life of people, all right? Because a lot of times people are going, okay, I think we have an insider threat. How do I determine that, okay? Or other scenarios, we're hiring new people. What's the risk we're taking on by hiring this particular person? Mm-hmm. All right, because maybe it's a big mouth all over the internet. You don't know that as HR, but it's gonna be a high enough level person in the company. It could drastically, if something goes wrong, it could impact the stock prices.
Sure. It sounds a lot like, well, is it like an Ocean's 11 type project where you got the guy and he's up there tapping into the wire and he's taking over the camera? It's probably a lot less glamorous than that.
I'm glad you brought up cameras because cameras were always my favorite weak spot.
Yeah.
Okay, and that comes back to, you know, where we're going with asymmetric, because it's more like a combination of cyber and physical. Okay, because the biggest problem has always been, so you have your cybersecurity team, okay? They could be total rock stars. They have the best CISO, good budget, everything else. But then you have your physical security team that has these, you know, security components that they don't know about, okay? Because your chain of reporting is, all right, physical security reports to HR, which reports to facilities, then to HR. Mm-hmm. They have no clue of each other, and they're nowhere in the same reporting structure.
Right.
All right, and that becomes, yeah, because just like marketing is usually the biggest risk, because half the times from a security perspective, you don't know what marketing's spinning up. And if you don't know your assets or what they're spinning up, how do we know which information they're collecting? Like at this conference, you've seen it numerous times. Marketing information has been compromised of all people that go and get their badge swiped, okay? You know, and that could be done through an API hack, okay? So marketing spun it up, but did anybody do a security assessment on the stuff that they're using? Or it could be a third party and they didn't do an assessment.
If I keep talking to you, I'm never gonna wanna go to a conference again. I'm just gonna wanna stay home.
That's why I have a Faraday bag.
Yeah, there you go.
Even a Faraday wallet.
Yeah, actually I do have one of those, so don't think about doing it. No, this is fascinating. Thank you so much for being on the podcast today. This is great. So I hope you found this episode eye-opening and thought-provoking. As you can see, AI is a double-edged sword in cybersecurity that can both protect us and harm us in the digital realm. And the insights shared by Tom show us the minds of both security professionals and hackers alike, and it's going to be a powerful tool in both of their toolboxes. It's a rapidly evolving landscape, and those who are designated to protect us in the digital realm will have to remain vigilant to keep up with the latest threats. But rest assured, the security champions will be there on the forefront to keep you updated with the latest insights as AI reshapes the cybersecurity industry. Scott Moore, thanks for joining us today.